Randeep, shall we start?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. Kashi, are you ready?
Sure, sir. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Can I request our program director, Dr. Randeep Singh, to please thank all the faculty and the participants for joining us today. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Kashish, and thanks to all the participants and faculty member. I mean, it is a pleasure to have senior faculties like Purvish sir and Atul Sharma sir to chair the session, as well as we have our colleagues Viraj, Bhavesh, Sumit, and thanks to all the other faculty as well as the delegates and senior colleagues who are there. The main plan was to talk about the updates which have come. There have been some really exciting data which have been presented. We are focusing majorly on metastatic colorectal cancer today. So I will be talking about few studies, and then there will be a discussion that how do we change the sequence part of it. So I would now request our chair for the session today, Dr. Atul Sharma sir and Dr. Purvish sir, to take the proceedings forward.
Dr. Purvish?
And I think you should go ahead, yeah.
All right. So probably it's a pleasure to probably a lot of changes have happened in the metastatic colorectal cancer. And you just recall a couple of days ago, there was a landmark study presented at ASCO, which probably is going to be very, very focused and probably going to make impact. The only problem is that the kind of the population which that study talked about, we may not see much in the sense, because only 5 to 7% of the patient will be exhibiting MSI instability. But still, if you see the survival for that progression-free survival, probably it is very, very significant, and that is single agent immunology. So let us see what is there offered. I'm sure there are many other advances and a lot of colorectal metastatic CRC, which used to be probably, there used to be dearth of drugs about a decade or decade and a half ago. But nowadays there are plenty, and probably many times we keep on struggling what to use the first line, because there are more than one combination which may work equally good or equally bad. So over to the first speaker.
Thank you very much, Atul. I think you have put the right context setting for the new advances in colorectal cancer. And Dr. Randeep Singh is a senior medical oncologist. He is director of medical oncology at NH Hospital. And he is a great academician. He has done so many activities for the juniors and students. So I'm sure all of us are in for another feast and pearls of wisdom from Dr. Randeep. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Purvish sir, and thank you, Atul Sharma sir. So, as Atul sir said, I think it is actually quite exciting to see the updates which have happened in colorectal cancer. So I will be covering these four abstracts. The first was actually a landmark paper also presented in the plenary session of use of checkpoint inhibitor in the first line metastatic colorectal cancer. The other two are mainly, as he said, that there is now no dearth of drugs, and the two trials of HER2 positive colorectal cancer and BRAF positive colorectal cancer phase 3 have opened the whole arena for targeted therapy. And the last is the final word for stage 3 colon cancer. So in next 15 to 18 minutes, I would just present the key highlights of the data presented in the ASCO 2020 as well as the recent conferences. So starting with the first trial, it's the Keynote 177, a phase 3 randomized trial in patients of metastatic colorectal cancer, which are having a microsatellite instability or mismatch repair deficiency. This is the schema of the trial, MSI high by PCR. And we know that when we do it by IHC, we call it as deficient MMR. Stage 4 colorectal cancer, treatment naive in the metastatic setting, or they have received some chemotherapy in the adjuvant, but in the metastatic, they are treatment naive. They have been randomized to pembrolizumab up to 35 cycles, which is around 2 years of pembrolizumab. And the second is the investigator choice chemotherapy, which is either a FOLFOX or FOLFIRI with anti-VEGF or anti-EGFR. And then there was an option of crossover, and to the extent of 30% to 50%. 30% crossover happened in the trial design, and almost 50% of the trial design, another 20% of the trial design were crossed over to pembrolizumab later in the disease course. The primary endpoint was dual, the PFS, which was presented in this meeting, and OS, which is immature and not presented. Most of the patients were as per the routine, 63 years median age. More patients were right-sided as we have more MSI positivity on the right side. What was interesting was that if you see the last part of where the arrow is on the screen, around 1/4 were all RAS wild type, 1/4 were BRAF mutant, 1/4 were KRAS mutant, and others it was not evaluable. So this was the data set which was included. Most of the patients, as I've seen, adjuvant was received only by 1/4. Majority of them presented with treatment naive metastatic CRC. As sir said, the PFS curves, you can see they are absolutely separating far wide, with the median PFS of 16.5 to 8.2 months, and at 2 years, 48% of the patients vis-a-vis 19% of the patients are disease-free on pembrolizumab versus chemo. What is to be observed is that in the initial part of the trial and curves, that in the first 6 months, there is a crossover happening. And after 6 months, the pembrolizumab has crossed over and shown a significantly better progression-free survival. If you see the forest plot, most of the diamonds are to the left, which is favoring pembrolizumab, except one, though the numbers, it is a subgroup analysis, but KRAS mutant was seen that it is the diamond is in the middle, which is to one extent not favoring immunotherapy. Coming to response rates, this was also encouraging, 67% versus 51%. So there were more patients who were responding to pembrolizumab. But as seen in head and neck trial data, as well as other trials where single agent immunotherapy have been used, the one which is focused in the red box is the progressive disease. And progressive disease is 30% in the pembrolizumab arm vis-a-vis 12% in the chemotherapy arm. And this is a huge difference. And I think this data is the one which is contributing to the crossover of the curves at 6 months. Coming to adverse events, pembrolizumab is fairly well tolerated. If we just focus on the upper two rows, treatment-related adverse events is 80% in pembrolizumab and 100% in chemo combination arm. Grade 3 are 22% in pembrolizumab and 66% in chemotherapy arm. So it is a fairly safe drug. The more of GI toxicity was seen in chemotherapy arm and more of immune-related side effects were seen in pembrolizumab arm. Coming to the second trial, which is a drug called trastuzumab deruxtecan. All those of us who are treating breast cancer, we know this drug has shown very encouraging data for HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer after the failure of 2 lines or as well as 3 to 4 lines. And similarly, this drug is being tried in metastatic colorectal cancer, HER2-positive, as well as in HER2-positive metastatic gastric cancer. So this is the DESTINY-CRC trial. This trial schema is metastatic CRC, HER2 expression. The HER2 expression was either by IHC 3+ or IHC 2+ and FISH positive. These are patients have to be BRAF wild type and they must have already been exposed to 2 regimens. They were randomized. It's a phase 2 trial. Sorry, there was no randomization. The cohort A data was of HER2 positive, 3+ or IHC 2+ FISH positive. Cohort B is FISH negative and cohort C is IHC 1+, which is not presented in detail in this trial. Also, one thing is to be noted that the drug dose is 5.6 in breast cancer or 5.4 in breast cancer, but here 6.4 mg per kg, a higher dose has been used, and I don't know the reason. I could not find why this has been, a higher dose has been chosen for colorectal. Patients were heavily pretreated. All of them had received either a FOLFOX-FOLFIRI type of combination and also anti-VEGF or anti-EGFR. So it is almost a third or fourth line of therapy. What is encouraging or what is there that this is a resistant subset, 30% of the patients were already subjected in this cohort A to some sort of anti-HER2 therapy which can be either trastuzumab, lapatinib or pertuzumab. Coming to the results, the overall response rate is 45.3%, which is actually encouraging in the subset or in the line where we are using this drug. Other thing is that the PD is progressive disease is only 9.4%, and achieving a disease control rate of 83% to my mind is astounding after usage of FOLFOX, FOLFIRI, cetuximab, bevacizumab, and trastuzumab. PFS median 6.9 months. Overall survival not reached till date in this subset. It is a reasonably well-tolerated drug. All the light blue bars are grade 1, grade 2 side effects. It causes some myelotoxicity and nausea, vomiting. But what is worrisome, apart from grade 1, grade 2 myelosuppression and nausea, vomiting, is interstitial lung disease. Grade 3 side effects and grade 2, around 4% had grade 2, grade 3 interstitial lung disease. And what is worrisome is the last grade 5, which means 2.6 or 2 patients out of 78 died of interstitial lung disease, in spite of the investigators being aware of this side effect and usage of steroid. This fatal side effect has happened, and we shall always rule out ILD by a CT scan and a pulmonary consult if we feel so before putting the patients on this drug. Coming to the third trial is a Beacon CRC. This is also a very interesting trial. It is a trial of, we already have seen the data of usage of a BRAF and a MEK inhibitor along with cetuximab. And this data, I think, was presented a year before. This is the extension Beacon CRC, which is a three-arm trial where encorthinib and binitumab, encorthinib is a BRAF inhibitor and binitumab is a MEK inhibitor that has been combined with cetuximab. That is a triplet regimen. Has been compared to a doublet regimen of only encorthinib and cetuximab, which is a BRAF inhibitor. And Can I just stop and reshare, Kashish?
Sure, sir, you can do that.
Just a minute. Sorry for this interruption. I will just stop and reshare the screen. Okay. Sorry for this interruption. I will just, I think there was a connection with my phone. Okay. So we were here. So this is the trial schema. Am I okay, Kashish? Good to go?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Sorry for this interruption. So the phase 3 trial, the other was encorthinib cetuximab, which was compared, and the third was FOLFIRI plus cetuximab. Primary endpoint of this trial was the triplet regimen compared to the control. The control is FOLFIRI plus cetuximab or irinotecan plus cetuximab. And there was a updated survival analysis as well as overall response analysis in this study where it was presented. Coming to the inclusion criteria, the median age was 62 years. Again, it was more of a right-sided colon predominant, 56 versus 35. Prior lines of therapy, this combination was used as 65% were already received one line of therapy and 35% had received more than two lines of therapy. So basically it was used either as a second line or a third or fourth line regimen. And 10% of these patients were MSI high across the subset. Coming to the trial results, this is an overall survival analysis. When we see the control arm, which is a chemotherapy arm with cetuximab, and we compare it with the triplet regimen of encorthinib, binitumab, cetuximab, the median is 9 versus 5.4 month overall survival. The doublet regimen also produces similar result of 8.4 versus 5.4. Coming to the response rates, the triplet regimen of encorphinib binicitux or a doublet regimen of encorphinib cetuximab, both are causing the response rates of 20-25%. Whereas it is surprising that the control arm has a response rate of only 2%. Now, this curve actually summarizes a lot, and it also tells that whether you use a triplet or a doublet, there is no difference in the updated median overall survival. The median overall survival stands at 9.3, whether you use binitumab or not, with cetuximab and encorpanib, and the control arm is at 5.9 months. So at 12.8 months, there is no difference between the two regimens. And recently, I think in April 2020 or May, the FDA gave an approval of usage of encorpanib and cetuximab in BRAF metastatic colorectal cancer. Coming to the updated overall survival analysis, if you see the subgroup analysis of the triplet versus doublet, I have just put the triplet and doublet regimen comparison. Most of the diamonds are in the middle, except one which is about the number of prior number of organs involved. If you see less than two organs involved, it is favoring doublet. But when we come to three or more organ involved, or we come to the more higher tumor burden, then the triplet regimen is preferred. And else all the other regimens are almost equivalent. Coming to adverse events, most of them are GI adverse events and anemia. And all the adverse events in the triplet regimen are double of that of doublet regimen. As you can see, diarrhea, abdominal pain, nausea, compared to doublet, the triplet are almost double in the numbers. Coming to the last data which has been presented is actually again the IDEA trial. I mean, to this August audience and faculty, we all know the schema of this trial. It was actually, I included this as the final word on what do we do about the adjuvant therapy of stage 3 colon cancer. We all know that we now divide stage 3 colon cancer into a low risk and high risk, and a node positive T3N0 and T3N1 comes in a low risk. T4 or any N2, N3 comes in a high risk colon cancer. This update analysis was comparison of 3 versus 6 months of CAPOX or FOLFOX type of regimen, and it was a non-inferiority trial design. This is a median follow-up of 6 years, and we already know that the patient's subset were among the 6 trials which were included in this meta-analysis, and that's why T3 is 65% and T4 ranges from 10 to 30%. N1 is 72 and N2 is 28, and majority of the patients had FOLFOX 60%, whereas 40% had CAPOX. Coming to the overall survival, and this is exactly a screenshot of what was presented at ASCO 2020, and it was clearly said that the debate is over and there is a clearly superior advantage of 3 months, as we can see that the curves are hugging each other and there is no difference in between 3 and 6 months. Also, when we see the overall survival by regimen, the CAPOX as well as FOLFOX, though there is slightly better advantage with CAPOX, hazard ratio of 0.96 with CAPOX and 1.07 with FOLFOX also says that 3 versus 6 months are equal. Coming to this curve, which summarizes that if we have to use a drug, when we classify the stage 3 into low risk, whether it is low risk FOLFOX or low risk CAPOX, there is not much difference. Of course, low risk FOLFOX has a delta of -0.3, whereas low risk CAPOX has a positive delta of 2.3. So dealing with a low risk stage 3 colon cancer, a CAPOX is preferred, but if someone is using a 3 month of FOLFOX, it is fine. Coming to a high risk stage 3 colon cancer, using FOLFOX is detrimental with a delta of -2.8%, which is also clinically significant. Whereas if you feel that the patient may have substantial toxicity, then you can easily use a 3 month CAPOX even with a high risk stage 3 colon cancer. But yes, you lose out on an overall survival and advantage of -1.0%. So only a 1% advantage is what you lose. Why it was said that the debate is over is this curve, which clearly shows that the overall survival, that the neurotoxicity is 5 times more when you use 6 months of CAPOX and FOLFOX, and number needed to treat are 3 versus 100, whereas number needed to harm are 32 versus 100. And I think if as a medical oncologist, we keep this slide in mind, we will be very comfortable in prescribing 3 month CAPOX to most of our patients. So this is the summary and the last slide. And I have divided into clinically relevant, practice changing, toxicity profile, and cost efficiency. Coming to pembro versus chemo, Yes, it is clinically relevant. 16.5 PFS versus 8.2, almost doubling. Practice changing, yes, but for less symptomatic, good PS patients who can who are not imminent of dying of the disease within 3 to 4 months. A very favorable toxicity profile, but cost efficiency for India is poor. For a 16-month cost or for a 1 year cost will be around 1 crore for this molecule. Trastuzumab duloxetine, clinically relevant, yes. 45.3% response rate in later lines. Yes, it is only for select group of patients, HER2 positive. A favorable toxicity profile except interstitial lung disease. Cost efficiency, we don't know. Just before this seminar, I just got a message from the company which arranges international drug. According to that calculation, a 100 mg vial of trastuzumab duloxetine is $5,200. And if you convert into around 400 mg with the dosage, it will come to around 14 lakhs per dose. Beacon CRC, it is of course clinically relevant. A doublet is preferred and it also FDA approved. Except we may use triplet in patients who are having a very high tumor burden. A favorable toxicity profile of doublet. We don't know the cost efficiency data. And stage 3 adjuvant CAPOX and FOLFOX, it is clinically relevant. It is practice changing, both for low risk and high risk. It has a 3 to 4 times less neuropathy. And of course, when we reduce the duration, it will become cost efficient. I think with this, I summarize and end my talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Randeep. That was really fantastic. These four very recent data that has been made available to us are really going to change how we are going to treat the patients. And especially the IDEA data that you showed is relevant in the COVID situation as well, because it will help reduce toxicity as well as reduce the risk of people to have a problem. So Dr. Bhavesh has a question for you. How, even for high risk stage 3 colon cancer, CAPOX is better than FOLFOX? So do you, what are your comments?
Bhavesh, if you are using 3 months, what I wanted to say CAPOX is better than FOLFOX is that if you are using 3 months of therapy, then CAPOX is better than FOLFOX for high risk. Now we come to CAPOX versus, within the CAPOX regimen, if you have to compare 3 versus 6 months of CAPOX, I agree with you. I was also having an idea that a high risk stage 3 colon cancer, which is N2 or T4, shall be subjected to at least 6 months of CAPOX or FOLFOX. But you are only losing a 1% delta advantage in the overall survival. And this is a 6 months follow-up. We can't have a longer follow-up required. And if the patient is agreeing to lose a 1% OS advantage, then I'm absolutely comfortable in using a 3 months CAPOX. What I gain is a 4 to 5 times less neurotoxicity. And I think that is actually very relevant, because by giving him 6 months of CAPOX, we may give him 30 out of 100 patients, 30 patients may get more neuropathy. So after this updated analysis, I will be actually very keen to offer everyone 3 months of CAPOX.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Randeep. We now move to the next speaker, Dr. Vivek Agarwala, who is a dear friend from NIH Hospital in Kolkata. Over to you, Vivek.
I hope I'm audible, sir.
Visible and audible, both.
Okay. Shall I share the screen or?
Please continue. Yes,
sir. Okay. Okay, so today I am to talk about tegaful-uracil. So this is something which is completely opposite to what the theme of the current meeting is. That is the recent update. So there is nothing recent about this molecule tegaful-uracil. So let's see what we can discuss about it. So tegaful-uracil, it is a combination in 1:4 ratio of two drugs, tegafur, which is the prodrug of 5-FU, and uracil, which is a competitive inhibitor of DPD, which metabolizes the active 5-FU molecules. So this combination actually is quite efficient because it decreases the catabolism of 5-FU. Next. It increases the plasma and tumor concentration of 5-FU. It allows the use of a lower dose of 5-FU with an equal efficacy. And next, it decreases the toxicity of 5-FU. Next. So when you look at the drug development, so this drug was quite developed in the early 1970s by Taiho Pharmaceuticals Tokyo. And the initial trials which was conducted in US NCI in the 1970s was actually using an IV formulation. The oral formulations were subsequently more developed in Japan, and it has been commercially available in Japan since 1984, being used in colorectal cancer as well as in other solid tumors. So the conventional phase 1, phase 2 trials of the oral 5-FU, oral UFT actually started in the US in the early 1990s. And the biochemical modulation by introducing leucovorin in combination with UFT was again started in the US trials only. Next. So if you look at the earlier clinical studies, what this study shows that at equimolar dosages, UFT was able to deliver a higher peak plasma 5-FU concentration with similar 5-FU exposure compared with a low dose protracted infusion of 5-FU. Thank you. Next. So before, without going into much details of the phase 1 studies, what we can conclude is that they showed that the recommended phase 2 dose was 300 milligram per meter square, which was to be divided in 3 doses daily, along with oral 5-FU, oral leucovorin 50 milligram with each dose, to be used for 28 days continuously with a 7 days gap. So each cycle is of 35 days. And with this, they were able to show a 25% response rate in colorectal cancers with UFT, which increased to around 40% when it was combined with leucovorin. And what it also showed was that neutropenia, significant mucositis, and hand-foot syndrome was not observed with UFT leucovorin, which was a favorable toxicity profile compared to the IV 5-FU leucovorin. Next. These are the early phase 2 efficacy single arm trials, which showed that the response rate varied from around 25% to 40%. Next. So if you look at this table from this article around 22 years ago, so we really baffled to see that this is what we actually require from a drug currently in the COVID era. So what we need is, it was an oral treatment without significant neutropenia, stomatitis, hand-foot syndrome, or alopecia. No need for weekly complete blood counts and reduced toxicity-related hospitalization. So before we go on to the other phase 2 and phase 3 studies, let us first resolve this question. Next. That why are we actually discussing this molecule in 2020? I mean, this drug, there's nothing new about this drug. And it is such an old drug, it's not even mentioned in any of the standard guidelines. And if you talk about an oral 5-FU alternative, we already have capecitabine. It is cheap, it is easily available, globally used, and is recommended by all the guidelines. Next. So the main reason why UFT has not been used so frequently is that from the late 2000s, UFT is not available in US. It is not therefore mentioned in any of the standard guidelines like NCCN. It is not approved by FDA, not approved by EMA, and not approved in Canada. It is not available freely in all these countries. Next. But why we should not junk this molecule is because it is still approved and available in more than 50 countries. The earlier trials in the GI cancers and colorectal cancers actually used capecitabine preferentially due to wider availability. So probably UFT was unlucky to not have a similar chance as capecitabine, and therefore probably it is not utilized to its potential. Next. Now if you look at the different guidelines which stress on the management of GI and colorectal cancers in the current pandemic, all the guidelines are stressed on patient safety as well as optimizing treatment efficacy and switching to oral treatments. Next. And if you look at the other alternatives of 5-FU other than capecitabine, so we have S1, which is again a combination of tegafur as well as other DPD molecules, but it is not available in India. Trifluridine tipiracil is again not available in India and also potentially toxic. So what we are left with actually is UFT to discuss if we are not using capecitabine. Next. And we all know capecitabine is not holy water. I mean, although it is oral, but we cannot use it in renal dysfunction. It can be potentially fatal in DPD mutant population, which is almost 3% homozygous and 10% heterozygous. It can have fatal cardiotoxicity in 3% population. It has severe adverse events in the elderly population. And almost 30 to 60% patients require dose modification. There are grade 3, grade 4 toxicities. In various trials are almost 15% grade 3, grade 4 diarrhea, 15% HFS, and almost 12 to 19% hepatotoxicity. Next. And we all know that capecitabine is not the globally used standard oral 5-FU alternative. So we have S1, which is more commonly used in certain countries like China, Korea, Taiwan, and Japan. Next. So definitely UFT does have a role in certain patients, probably almost up to 30% of the patients who would have.
Sir, can you hear us? We're not able to hear you, sir.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So UFT leucovorin probably would be much safer to capecitabine, probably with equal efficacy. And how do we identify these patients? So probably all DPT mutant patients, we should prefer UFT. Elderly patients more than 65 to 70 years of age, we should prefer UFT. Probably patients with renal dysfunction who have creatinine clearance of less than 45 ml per minute. Again, if you want to use something oral, we should prefer UFT. And again, if patients who have severe toxicities to capecitabine, there is a good option of switching to UFT. Next. So definitely UFT is a valid option and alternative to capecitabine. Next. Now let us look at some of the existing evidence of comparable efficacy and safety in the metastatic colorectal cancers. Next. So coming to first line metastatic colorectal cancer, next. So these are the most important two studies which used a single agent chemotherapy. So in these studies, which were published in 2002, tegafur-uracil was compared against a Roswell Park regimen of single agent 5-FU. So in the earlier Dulard study, it was equivalence design and the primary endpoint was OS. And in the Carmichael study, it was a non-inferiority design and the primary endpoint was TFS. Next. And these are the results of these studies. So what we see is that tegafur-uracil was able to achieve a similar response rate to 5-FU leucovorin, 11% compared to 14%. It was having a similar median time to progression, that is 3.5 months in both the arms. And the median overall survival was also similar, that is 12 months against 13 months. And in fact, in the Carmichael study, the median overall survival was slightly better with the tegafur-uracil, that is 12.2 months as against 10.3 months. Next. Now coming to the toxicities. So what we can see clearly in this study is that the neutropenia with tegafur-uracil was significantly less, 1% against 56%. The febrile neutropenia was significantly less, 0% against 13%. And the non-hematologic toxicities also, like stomatitis, was significantly less, 1% against 19%. And the hand-foot syndrome was also not seen with tegafur-uracil. And similar data regarding toxicity was also reflected in the Carmichael study. Next. This is another interesting study where patient was randomized to tegafur-uracil in one arm, whereas 5-FU leucovorin in the another arm. And in the second cycle, they were switched to the other arms. And then at the end of the second cycle, a preference of was noted. Next. So 84% of the patients actually preferred tegafur-uracil in this study because it was a medication taken at home. There were no painful sores in the mouth. It did not cause diarrhea because it was an oral treatment and it did not interfere with daily activities. Next. And in the same study, what we can see is that tegafur-uracil was found to be more resource saving because it required less hospitalization, less outpatient visits, and less concomitant medications. Next. This is another study where tegafur-uracil was compared in Japanese patients as against United patients of United States. So what was found was that the response rates was similar in both these patients, but the diarrhea was much higher in the Americans, that is 22% as against 9% in the Japanese. So probably ethnic differences do make a difference when we look at the toxicities to 5-FU-leucovorin and its congeners. Next. So what we can see from all these studies is that 5-FU was that tegafur-uracil with leucovorin was found to be having equivalent efficacy to bolus 5-FU-leucovorin with clinically significant safety advantages. It was preferred and it caused less diarrhea in the Asian patients, but more diarrhea in the American patients. But despite these studies, I mean, we don't find large studies of tegafur-uracil later on. Next. So let us see some of the small combination studies of tegafur-uracil. Next. So this was one of the earlier phase one studies of tegafur-uracil, where it was combined with oxaliplatin, alternating with irinotecan in the subsequent as a first line treatment. So this study showed that it had 63% response rate, a median PFS of 8.7 months and a median OS of 16.8 months. And it showed that it had minimal neurotoxicity and minimal hand-foot syndrome. Next. So this was one of the another small studies where tegafiri was compared with tegafox as a first-line treatment for metastatic colorectal patients. Next. So the response rate was almost similar in both the arms, 40% in the tegafiri arm and 39% in the tegafox arm. Next. Similar median overall survival, 20 months against 19 months. And next, a similar median time to progression, that is 8 months. So just as we know that folfiri is same as folfox, tegafiri was also found to be similar to tegafox. Next. Again, this is another study where folfox was combined with cetuximab, was compared against ufox combined with cetuximab as first-line treatment. So this study again showed that in the KRAS wild-type population, the efficacy outcomes were completely same in the both the arms, showing that ufox with cetuximab is an acceptable treatment. Next. This is another study where tegafur-uracil was combined with bevacizumab in the elderly population more than 75 years of age. Next. So what this study showed was that the median overall survival was around 23 months, median PFS was 8.2 months, and the overall response rates was 40%. And when we compare this with the CAPE BEV arm of the AVEX study, so although cross-trial comparisons are not there, we can see that the UFT leucovorin plus bevacizumab had a significant response rate with a very comparable median PFS and OS, and the HFS, which was completely not seen with UFT leucovorin, whereas it was seen in almost 16% patients with K plus BEV. Next. This is another trial of tegafiri compared with folfiri. Next. So this study showed that the response rates are quite similar, almost 56% in folfiri as compared to 66% in tegafiri. Next. And this shows that the median progression-free survival as well as the overall survival was quite similar in the tegafiri and the folfiri arms. Next. Looking at the toxicities, so neutropenia was significantly less, almost 50% in the tegafiri arm as compared to folfiri, but diarrhea was slightly higher. Next. So what was concluded is that tegafiri plus bevacizumab is an effective and tolerable first-line regimen. Next. So what we can conclude from all these studies is that tegafur-uracil is an orally active prodrug of 5-FU with good activity in metastatic colorectal cancer, both alone as well as in combination with oxaliplatin or irinotecan, as well as the biologicals. Next. Now coming to 5-FU-capecitabine-induced cardiotoxicity, again, it is a very lethal complication. Next. And what was found in the preclinical studies and small studies is that the different cardiological complications are almost less than 1% with UFT as compared to almost 3% with 5-FU or capecitabine. Next. Again, when we look at the adjuvant setting, next. There are a lot of studies which show that when we look at use of single agent 5-FU, again, UFT leucovorin is a feasible option. Next. And when we look at beyond colorectal cancers also, next. we have multiple uses of UFT, particularly as an adjuvant therapy in non-small cell lung cancers. It finds good evidence. Next. Again, when we look at some of the other guidelines, next, we look at the NICE guidelines. There also UFT tegafur is recommended as an oral therapy along with capecitabine. Next. These are the Asian consensus guidelines who suggest that S1 or UFT can also be used. Next. And these are the Japanese guidelines which show that in the metastatic colorectal cancers along with bevacizumab, UFT leucovorin is an approved treatment. Next. This is the updated Japanese guidelines. Next. And it still says that yes, UFT with bevacizumab is an approved treatment. Next. So what we can conclude from today's presentation is that the tegafur uracil is a viable alternative to oral 5-FU. Oral capecitabine S1 or an IV 5-FU leucovorin. It has comparable efficacy and better safety profile. It may be preferable in patients at higher risk of toxicities, that is those who have DPD mutation, elderly age, compromised renal function, and those with history of cardiotoxicity. UFT further assumes more importance in today's COVID era, where focus is more towards safety in optimizing cancer care. And yes, we definitely need more well-designed multinational phase 3 randomized studies which directly compare capecitabine and UFT to show that this molecule does certainly has worth. Thank you.
Randeep, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there, sir.
Ha.
I think the next talk is by, sorry, I was so talk and I was actually concentrating on the talk. Vivek did a very beautiful job and there was a comment from Dr. Ajay sir also that someone has presented tegafur uracil in after a long time in such a beautiful way. Thank you, Vivek.
Thank you.
I would now request Purvish sir for his talk. We all know Purvish sir and his talk is, he has already shared the slide. His talk is about treatment adaptation for CRC in the COVID-19 era. And as it is a colorectal session, we will be focusing on the colorectal cancer only. Sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Randeep. And I've divided my talks into four different components. And the first is going to be focusing on what do we know about cancer and COVID in general. Can I go to the next slide, please? So look at this list of 399 healthcare professionals from NCR region who are affected with COVID. And there are two photographs. I'm sure that in a few months, none of us will recognize them except the families who have lost these stalwarts, one from Indore and one from Delhi. So the first point that I would like to make is that COVID is a serious illness. COVID is here that can significantly affect doctors who are at the front line of this fight against cancer as well as COVID. Next slide. So this is again data that was recently published, presented at ASCO 2020. And this is about 928 consecutive patients in the Cancer Consortium COVID registry, which was funded by the NIH and the American Cancer Society. So this was really genuine because there was no industry-sponsored program. And 39% of these patients were receiving active cancer treatment and 43 had measurable disease. And out of these 928, 121 patients, that is 13%, died. And this death occurred within 30 days of diagnosis of COVID. So 13% death is a high risk for our patients with cancer, and this should be kept in mind. Next. Now, among the patients who died, 41 had active, stable, or responsive cancers, and 25 had progressive cancers. What that means is that it is not just active or on treatment patients who are dying. There are patients who are stable with cancer or also dying. If these patients were hospitalized, 23% died. If they were admitted to an ICU, the death increased to 38%. And if they required intubation, almost 43% died. So almost half of them. Next. Independent risk factors for mortality in these patients who died were male gender, former smokers, more than 75 years, and ECOG performance status 2. Now, this more than 75 years is a Western figure. This is from United States. Let us see what is the situation in India. Next slide. This is data from the government of Maharashtra. So this is official figures, okay? And this is the daily report that has come out on 16 June, that is just 2 days ago. If you look at the blue bars, you can see that more than 1 lakh patients are here, and that is the age distribution of the cases. And the maximum number of deaths in Maharashtra are between the age of 41 to 90 years. So it's not above 75 years. It is the young adults who are getting affected by this. Next. And this is the graph that shows the total COVID cases in India. On worldometer today at 12 o'clock, it was 367,396. And the graph keeps going up. But we should also know what is the current situation in our geography or our location. And the green graph on the left side, the blue graph on the left side shows India, whereas the orange one shows what is the situation in Maharashtra. And you can see that over the last 3 weeks, the number of new cases in Maharashtra are stabilizing. So are you in an area where the COVID is on the upward trend? Or are you in an area where COVID is stabilizing? Is important to decide what you want to do. Next. So the first thing that I do is to reduce my risk of being interacting with the patient by using the virtual clinic. And I think this is the biggest advantage for me that I can see. And I'm sure that many of you are also using it. As I see on WhatsApp, many of the DPs of people include their details about how they are using the virtual clinic. Next. The next point that I want to make is, how do I look after my staff? You know, this is a photograph of a doctor and nurse at a Sion hospital in Mumbai wearing the full PPE. And wearing and working in a full PPE is not a joke. Next slide. In my earlier life, I was looking after medical response and training in terms of medical disasters. And this is chemical, biological, radiation, and nuclear disasters. So I know what a full PPE is. I know that you cannot work for more than 2 hours under the stifling conditions of a full biological PPE. And this is something we need to keep in mind. Next slide. Just to take an example, if somebody has to go into the operation theater and operate, there are 9 different segments that person has to wear before he is fully ready. And this can take about half an hour. Donning is half an hour, doffing is half an hour. And this really adds to whatever is the tiresome mental and physical stress that our colleagues are facing. Next. So now we come to what is the chemotherapy for colorectal cancer. And this has been elegantly described by both Vivek and Randeep, but I have divided them into backbone and then backbone plus, which has bevacizumab, cetuximab, or panitumumab. Next slide. And then we have the more beyond these, which is the drugs that are immunotherapy as well as regorafenib. So we have 3 different groups of drugs that can be used for our patients with colorectal cancer. Next. So now, how do we reduce the risk during the COVID-19? So giving very bucket general answers, first is combining capecitabine and bevacizumab with a short IV infusion every 3 weeks, combined with the oral therapy, reduces the need to come to hospital frequently. Vivek has already elegantly showed how Tegafur and S1 can help us. And regorafenib has the advantage of less immunosuppressive action, as well as the dose escalation strategy, which optimizes by starting with 80 and then going on to 160 based on what are the side effects that the patient is going to suffer. And Randeep showed that Capox is preferred over FOLFOX, data from ASCO, the IDEA study. Next slide. So if you have to use 5-FU, avoid the bolus and continue the infusion only. Why? Because there is clear evidence that bolus toxicity is higher, especially neutropenia, mucositis, and diarrhea, which you do not want your patient to suffer from during the COVID era. Changing from IV 5-FU to oral 5-FU, everybody has said that, so I should not spend more time on it. But the dose can be 1,000 milligrams twice a day, and the dosage should be modified. The schedule can be modified to 7 days on and 7 days off to reduce the toxicity. Next. Another way of reducing toxicity is to skip one or two cycles of treatment with drugs who have a long half-life. For instance, bevacizumab maintenance or pembrolizumab as chronic therapy. If you miss out on one or two cycles, it is not going to have a major impact on the outcome. And you can extend the treatment interval by a week. So if it was a two-weekly schedule, we make it three-weekly. Or if it was three-weekly, make it monthly. And that should not have any significant detrimental effect. So these are general ideas on how you can reduce the risk. Next. Now let us look at this publication that came out just yesterday in the Indian Journal of Molecular and Pediatric Oncology, of which Padmaj Kulkarni is the editor-in-chief. And based on this publication from Indian experience and very good academic authors, I will focus on neoadjuvant setting, adjuvant setting, and metastatic setting. Next. So in the neoadjuvant setting, Foxtrot data clearly says that if you give chemotherapy, regression occurs in 59% of patients. And it reduces the risk of incomplete resection. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy works. So differing surgery is justified if necessary. But please understand that using neoadjuvant chemotherapy will not improve the disease-free survival or the overall survival. So if there's a patient who comes to me as a potentially curative disease and the surgeon has asked me for a neoadjuvant therapy, I would use Capox. Next. Now we move to the adjuvant setting. Please remember that not all patients should be given adjuvant chemotherapy. The absolute benefit of adjuvant chemotherapy is only 5%. And this benefit varies with stage of the disease and other key factors. So on the right side, the pink rectangle shows all the key factors, all the stages. But what is really important is MSI, MSS status, and whether there is more than one risk factor. Next. So this is my take on adjuvant setting for colon cancer. Benefit of chemotherapy component is maximum with 5-FU, and if you use an oral component of 5-FU, it is better. So omitting oxaliplatin for one or two cycles, I have no hesitation in doing. If it is MSI high disease, then Capox should be used. A single agent drug has no benefit. There was a discussion on the chat about low risk and high risk. So if there is a high risk stage 2 or a low risk stage 3, based on IDEA meta-analysis, I would say 3 cycles are adequate. If it is MSS with T4 or multiple risk factors, then I would use either 6 cycles of single agent capecitabine or 3 cycles of Capox. And if there is a pressure on the beds and staff because there is a surge of COVID patients, then I would defer oxaliplatin to later cycles. For high-risk stage 3, 6 cycles of chemotherapy are essential. And I would use at least 4 cycles of Capox. And maybe for the last 2 cycles, I would use single agent capecitabine. Next slide. Now, instead of colon cancer, if the disease were rectum cancer, and it would depend on whether the patient has achieved a pathological CR or not. If there's a pathological CR and lymph nodes were negative, then I would be happy to use oral capecitabine as a single agent. If there was no pathological CR, then the patient is at high risk, but there is no overall survival even if we give treatment. So I would give treatment only if the patient insists after no pathological CR. Next. What about metastatic colorectal cancer? In the 1980s, with best supportive care, the 5-year overall survival was only 5%. But that is not the case now. Now, if a patient comes with hepatic mets, the 5-year overall survival can be as high as 74% with a median of 38%, which we should not laugh at. If they have lung metastasis, the 5-year overall survival could be as high as 68%. And if a patient has unresectable colorectal cancer with liver-only metastasis, after neoadjuvant chemotherapy, 1/3 of these patients will be eligible for resection. So I would be happy to treat patients with metastatic colorectal cancer with the hope that there would be a long-term survival. If a patient with metastatic colorectal cancer comes who's got an asymptomatic primary tumor, I would not rush into immediate surgery for the primary tumor, and I would be happy to give chemotherapy first and defer the surgery to stable times. Next. So in the first line, if the patient is frail or unfit, I would use either best supportive care or single agent oral 5-FU. If the patient is fit, I would use CAPOX as a backbone and followed by capecitabine maintenance. In special circumstances, and that is because based on molecular testing, I would add cetuximab, bevacizumab or panitumumab as is shown in the red box here. Next slide. So all metastatic colorectal cancer should be tested at diagnosis for RAS and BRAF V600E mutation. Why? Because activating mutations in these instances means that they will not respond to EGFR inhibitors, which I should not use. EGFR antibodies should be given only to patients who are wild type for RAS. And if there's a BRAF V600E mutation, in addition to EGFR mutation, I will use a BRAF inhibitor. If the patient can't afford a BRAF inhibitor, there's no point in giving an EGFR inhibitor by itself. Next. Now let's say that the patient has come for second line treatment and earlier he had received oxaliplatin. Then I would use Kevfiri or Tegafiri. And if the patient is MSI-H or MMR deficient, then there is a case for adding immunotherapy drugs like ipilimumab, nivolumab, and pembrolizumab. Supposing the patient has come in third line setting, then I would treat the patient only if he insists. And the options that I would use are either checkpoint inhibitors, as mentioned in the second line, or anti-HER2 therapy or anti-BRAF therapy, as would be appropriate based on the testing of the patient. Next slide. Now, as far as checkpoint inhibitors are concerned, it is vital to find out MSI-MMR status prior to selecting the therapy. And in patients who have failed first-line therapy with 5-FU, oxaliplatin or irinotecan, they are supposed to be used. Next slide. Now, if I have to decide in this era how to treat the patient, I will make sure that I document for medical legal purposes every discussion and decision with a virtual tumor board. And at Chalbi Hospital, we do that regularly. And you can see here is an example where we have medical oncologists, surgical oncologists, radiation oncologists, pathologists, as well as the radio diagnosis expert as part of our virtual tumor board. Next slide. So many doctors and colleagues have said that while COVID deaths are only 4.5 lakhs, which is as of today at noon, 6,94 patients of colorectal cancer die every year. And therefore, we should not hesitate to treat colorectal cancer. I entirely agree with that. But I also ask myself this question. How many of these deaths will I be preventing by giving the treatment to this patient? The COVID death can be more imminent and more acute, whereas adjuvant therapy shows that benefit is there only in 15% of patients. So I have to individualize for the patient who is sitting in front of me. Next slide. So there are two slides for take-home message and the conclusion. I would say that the first principle is stay at home as much as possible, both for the patients as well as the healthcare professionals. Please remember that if something happens to your staff, only their family will bear the brunt. After a few months, everybody will forget what is happening. NCCN is not applicable to all our patients. It is time to weigh the pros and cons carefully. Expected benefit of chemotherapy versus increasing risk of death due to COVID-19 is what is in the mind when I decide about these patients. Next. Oral single agent chemotherapy should be the default choice. Capecitabine, Tegafur, S1. Also consider regorafenib because of the advantages that I mentioned earlier. If chemo combination is a must, the default choice should be CAPOX. 3 to 4 cycles to be considered, and after that, maybe single agent could be benefit. If oxaliplatin needs to be discontinued for any time, it can be added later once the COVID resolves in your own locality. Finally, use all possible options to minimize need to enter hospitals and daycare center. Next slide. And if you really want to know more about colorectal cancer and GI, I invite you to this virtual meeting that is from 24 to 26. That is Oncology Chakruvyuh GI Conference. And the program director for that is Dr. Vikas Talreja. With that, I thank you for a very patient hearing and hand it over back to the organizers.
Thanks, Parvish. Really, you covered all the aspects of colorectal cancer from the adjuvant, metastatic, and what are the latest update. Randeep?
Thank you, sir. And we will now go for the panel discussion. And for the panel discussion, the moderator is Viraj. Dr. Viraj is there. Dr. Viraj is a senior consultant from Ahmedabad. And Viraj, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there.
Okay. And can you call the panelist? I think Dr. Sumit is there.
I'm there.
Dr. Bhavesh Parekh is there.
Now, no more tired.
Kashish, can you help me? I think I am missing out on
Dr. Vishwanath.
I'm here.
Over to you, Viraj. I think we have three only, the panelists.
Okay, three. So I would also ask Randeep sir to join us in the panel discussion.
Sure. Okay, I'm there. I'm available.
Right. So thank you, Randeep sir. Thank you, Purvis sir. Thank you, organizers, for having me here. Fantastic discussion on colorectal cancer. And my job is the last session before our dinner. And so as everybody has stuck to the time, I would also like to stick to time and we'll finish in 30 minutes. So this session is on how do we use all the agents that we know in a vast metastatic colorectal cancer. And I have just a couple of points as a take-home message today in 30 minutes that I want to deliver. And we will do that with just one case. And I want all four of you to join in all the questions that I have. So this is the only case we have. So male, money is not an issue, super rich fellow. Anemia for last 3 months, no other GI symptoms, no comorbidities, no GPSD, no family history. The colonoscopy showed a sigmoid colon mass. Biopsy was moderately differentiated adenocarcinoma. It was not mucinous. Ultrasound initially was done outside. It showed the liver was studded and there were a few retroperitoneal nodes. And the CEA was high, 700 plus. The CT scan, staging scan of thorax, abdomen, pelvis showed that the liver is completely studded and it cannot be cured surgically. And of course, there are more retroperitoneal disease as well. So let's not bring surgical aspect into this case. We will stick to purely medical oncology aspect. Now, this patient had a KRAS mutation, this particular mutation, exon 2 G12C, and also had MSI high. And this was the scan. Now, my question to all four of the panelists is, in your practice, and you can have just a couple of statements as the answer, how do you test in your clinical practice? Do you test them individually or do you test them with NGS in all one go? So we'll start with Dr. Sumit. Can I have your opinion?
You have to unmute your mic.
Sumit sir, you have to unmute your mic.
So this NCCN is from 2 years ago. And
we
NCCN already said you could do it with NGS, right?
Yeah, we are not doing with NGS at this point of time. We are doing MSI testing as part of reflex testing. We do in all patients irrespective of the stage. And KRAS, extended RAS panel, and BRAF, we do it in all patients as of now. And HER2-new and other mutations, we are not doing it upfront.
Okay. Randeep sir, what about you?
Sandeep, you have to unmute your mic.
Yes. So I'm audible. Yes, no. So
yeah.
We order KRAS, NRAS, BRAF, and MSI, all four together, but as a separate test, not as a panel of NGS.
Bhavish, sir?
Same as Sumit and Randeep, but with this new ESCO 2020 guidelines, I think HER2-new and this all should be incorporated. But till that, I am just using as a separate tumor markers rather than NGS in a metastatic colorectal day one.
So you agree of by doing NGS day one?
No. I am not doing or I am not agreeing on day one doing NGS.
Okay. Dr. Vishwanath, sir?
So I agree with the other panelists. I don't do an NGS, but I, in most of my patients, I do the extended RAS panel as well as the HER2 and MSI.
Right. So all of our, anybody in audience wishes to say that they would like to do NGS day one? Anybody who is there? Why am I asking?
Viraj,
is,
can I come?
Yes, sir.
Viraj, we are not against NGS. It is not that, I mean, if there is a standardized NGS which we rely upon, I will be happy that you get all the information. It is so a similar discussion of lung cancer, that gradually the number of mutations.
So this patient has no money issue and foundation is available with you. Would you do it on day one?
Yeah. If available, I will do it.
So you would do it?
Yeah.
Why do you do it, sir?
The other thing is the
patient on day one. Dr. Sumit?
Yeah, if the option is there, I will do it upfront. If like logistics is not an issue and foundation one is there, definitely I will do it upfront. I don't mind doing it.
Right. So what are the additional alterations you are expecting to see on day one NGS in this patient?
See, one, I can decide about the future, like the, I want to know whether HER2NU is there or not. And MSI we have already done. Apart from that, if RAS and RAF is wild type, then the chances of HER2NU amplification is likely to be more. And if it RAS is mutated, then HER2 amplification is also likely to be less. That is one thing. Second thing is small mutation like NTRK and all, whether we can pick and we can see for future this thing that we can plan from now. That is the only aspect.
Right.
Viraj, you have one extra thing which you can get if you really rely, there is a very, I mean, peculiar indication that you can use pembrolizumab for all MSI, all TMB high patients. And there is also some data of Nivo plus EP combination. I will not use it, but that is one added point which you can do by foundation and find TMB. Right. But actually, to summarize, I don't find that NGS will give anything very great as compared to the reflex testing. But it is an option to be used.
Right. Dr. Vishwanath, you have any comment? If there are unlimited...
So that the only other point is the... also, the other thing, the problem with NGS is the turnaround time. If you send it to Foundation One, it takes around 3 to 4 weeks. That's also another flaw with the NGS.
Mm-hmm. All right. So why I kept this here is because I wanted to discuss what are the additional advantages and why NCCN has decided to keep NGS as an option there, right along with so this was a very small study, 150 patients on Foundation. And what they found that apart from the KRAS mutations that we normally get when we test them to RT-PCR, we also have something called as RAS amplifications, which we never test because we test for RAS mutations. Now, about 2% of your colorectal patients can have RAS amplifications. And we have studies stating that even there is RAS amplification and not mutation, they are mutually exclusive, you are not going to benefit if you add anti-EGFR therapy. This paper is pretty old, 2009 paper. We know this, that there are alterations which are not standardly picked by standard our RT-PCR. Mm-hmm. What Dr. Sumit Goyal also said, that there is something HER2 copy number variations which will not pick up on your IHC testing of HER2. And we know that HER2 is a negative predictor marker for use of anti-EGFR. These are the tests you will only get if you do NGS. And very importantly, Dr. Randeep sir, you started with pembrolizumab talk, and everybody gets excited when you have MSI high, and we all say patient is going to do well. And it was a very nice editorial a year ago that it was supposed to work. Why it didn't work? And even in that pembro trial, if you see 20% of them, the curve crossing in the first 6 months, they do worse than chemo. So who are these patients? Who are these patients who are MSI high but still do worse than chemo? And again, to suggest very interesting study, just 17 patients, MSI high, they also did TMB, like you said, TMB. And what they found, if you have MSI high but low TMB, the pembro did not work in these cases. So something very interesting. We have to learn a lot based on interaction between TMB and MSI High. But I'm pretty sure that there is a lot more than having MSI High and putting Pembro for the patient. I think so there is a lot more information you could have. So if given a choice, I think so this is a valid and straightforward option to do NGS on day one. Right, with that aside, so anybody has question on that? Right, so let's move to the second part of it. So now this patient has MSI high, young fellow, 48 year old, no major symptoms, but the disease burden is a lot. So I want all four of you to tell me, would you use immunotherapy first line or go with standard chemo plus or minus Bev? So EGFR is out from this discussion. So we'll start with Bhavesh, sir. What about you?
Viraj, your history like high tumor burden, I will again talk with my surgeon that whether by giving chemo this unresectable or bilobar liver mets can we make resectable, because this is the most important part. If by giving any chemotherapy, if make this unresectable at present, if we make resectable, then I definitely I will use the FOLFOX. Again, so many discussion was going on about the oxaliplatin or irinotecan, because that doing the cholestasis or that having any hamperment on the liver tissue. So at present with this, I will definitely use doublet. I will not use triplet. And bevacizumab, again, I feel personally for this patient that it will be wonderful drug and I will use bevacizumab. But again, to consider that if I am going to do a surgery, then I have to stop before 4 to 6 weeks of surgery, bevacizumab also.
This patient has, sir, I completely agree with you. There is extrahepatic disease here. So let surgery out, because in an extrahepatic disease, I don't think a surgeon should be brought in. So if this patient is purely palliative, where we do not consider surgery, what would be your treatment options?
Recently, Purvis Parikh also told in the metastatic setting, or we are in the COVID era, Capox will be the very best option also. But still, I will still prefer in a metastatic colorectal, FOLFOX rather than Capox.
FOLFOX with bevacizumab.
Yes.
And would reserve immunotherapy for later lines?
Yes.
Okay. Dr. Sumit Goyal, what about you?
Yeah, I also agree with Dr. Bhavesh, sir. Probably I will use the chemo first. And probably FOLFOX or Capox plus minus bevacizumab. Definitely my trend is towards using the bevacizumab now. And again, at some point of time, as the patient is having, though he is having extrahepatic disease, but if the burden of disease is predominantly hepatic, at some point of time, definitely I'm looking at doing the local therapy in the form of either TACE or Y90. It will give some added advantage. So I'm not ruling out local therapy, provided it is liver predominant disease and there is good control over.
This patient also has bone mets and lung mets. So let's
Then I will not. Then that part is out.
Okay.
Then I will not consider liver therapy.
Yes. So then what would be your treatment choice?
Chemotherapy plus bevacizumab.
What chemotherapy?
I will probably FOLFOX or Capox, depending upon patient's preference, and bevacizumab.
Dr. Randeep, sir?
Viraj?
Yes, sir. Atul, sir. Yes, please go ahead, sir.
So if I heard it clearly, the patient is MSI high.
Yes. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Randeep did a good job, so I'm curious to know.
Exactly.
I'm not using or suggesting immunotherapy. Just had the data presented 2 weeks ago, and where the median PFS is 16 months, median OS still mature. So I just want to know maybe that the cause, which probably because of the COVID or because of Randeep, what is your take on this?
I was actually smiling is because I was thinking of saying FOLFOX, Siri or Capox. I'm sorry to disappoint you, because the reason is this curve. I mean, the
whole session. Yeah, exactly. I agree with this curve. Yes.
The whole day started with this slide.
Yeah. I mean, the reason is this curve. Crossing
progression at 2 years with any therapy that we have today. So with this on our face, how are we justified in using?
Not an issue, of course. Probably it goes that without saying that probably checkpoint inhibitors should be the first choice, or some other.
I agree. Atul sir, I agree that checkpoint is the first choice. But Viraj was mentioning that there is a very high tumor burden, and the image which he shows, if you see that, there looks like that the patient may slip into liver failure. Now, we don't have the trial results out of chemo plus checkpoint inhibitor first line data. I mean, chemo plus pembro or chemo plus nevo. Atezolizumab trial is also going on. Now, seeing this image, and I will say that. Yes, Viraj, go ahead.
So I was saying in the trial that we showed 177, the response rate with single agent pembro is 45 plus, and that is the same response rate we would get with chemo. So there is no question about shrinking them faster with any other therapy.
Yeah. The only thing is we do not know. It takes 6 months time.
Vishwanath, can I have you in? What is your opinion?
Yeah. So even I would go with FOLFOX or CAPOX plus or minus bevacizumab. Only a word of caution that this patient has anemia. So I would make sure that this patient is not bleeding, and then probably add bevacizumab. And also, just to add to what you said, single agent pembro has 45% response rate. It's got 55 to 59% response rate.
Right. So that's higher, right?
Yeah, exactly. And this is a 48-year-old fit gentleman with a very good performance status.
Mm-hmm.
But Viraj, equally, there are 30% progression rates also as compared to 12% progression on chemo. That also I did show in the trial results, that the chances of progression are much more. And because of that progression, which is almost double the progression rate as compared to chemo, this is happening that the curve is crossing at 6 months.
That was the reason that
in the non-COVID era, I may directly go for FOLFOXIRI with BEV. So as to salvage the patient, it doesn't slip into liver failure. In a COVID era, I will just go with CAPOX and BEV, because we don't have beds and we don't want the patient to come in after toxicity.
Right. So Delhi is right now in a difficult situation. I agree. So I think
someone also mentioned that there is a probable poor availability of beds to manage the toxicity also.
Hmm. But the toxicity of single agent IO is less than chemo, right?
Yes.
So, like, I am pretty much convinced that it should be IO day one, because I don't see, we have seen 85% tumor shrinkage with any other therapy, maybe COVID era or non-COVID era. So I was thinking about discussing whether you would do pembro or nevo EP. Well, all of our panelists are not even considering. That's the googly.
Actually, the second thing is we do not know the sequencing. If pembro fails, whether how well the chemo will work or not. But if the chemo fails, whatever benefit we get, and subsequently we can add immunotherapy anyway.
So the wonderful part about this trial was that there was a 3-year data just orally, verbally said by Dr. Axel Grothy. He said about 30% of your patient will never require treatment ever.
Oh, okay.
They are potent with just single agent pembro. And I think so that that benefit is not, as far as I know, done by any other chemotherapy that we know today. That is an encouraging thing. That long, durable responses.
All right. Second, another advantage of using IO in this particular setting is that now we know at the end of 2 years. And if you want to use chemotherapy, of course, probably you would like to continue indefinitely. You may give treatment breaks in between, or you may put on someone on the maintenance. Here, probably there, the trial design itself suggests you just give it for 35 doses.
Yes. So I think so. It's a fair take-home message that if you have an unlimited resources and this particular patient, I think push for first-line pembro. I don't know about whether I will push for nevo EP because the data is even more encouraging with nevo EP. But since I would have those thoughts. So, okay. So just to twist, I did not give, so let's say this patient, you are all giving chemo and you all said doublet. You said FOLFOX and CAPOX is the panel answer, right? Why yeah. would anybody want to use triplet in this case?
I will not.
So I will like to use a triplet, provided I am ready with the bed and support services and others. And he's a 48-year PS0 chap. And since I'm not using immuno with the risk that patient may progress, that is the same discussion that I'm putting here that I would like to use FOLFOXIRI with BEV. Though I know with the TRIBE data that FOLFOXIRI works best in the right-sided tumor, young patient, PS0, BRAF positive. Still, it is a left-sided, I would still prefer a triplet.
So this is the slide which I have made and I've been showing this since last 1.5 years. I've compiled all the triplet data that we have for colorectal cancer with or without bevacizumab, and there are 5 major trials. Last 3 are the phase 3 trials with bevacizumab, and irrespective of sidedness, there is a PFS advantage and there is an overall survival.
Yes, sir.
And still, we have still not moved beyond a doublet in colorectal cancer, and I'm sure all of my panelists have used FOLFIRINOX in pancreatic cancer. I know Atul sir is using gallbladder cancer. So for any other cancer, we are using triplet, but somehow there is a resistance in triplet in colorectal cancer. So I want all of you to come in, Sumit sir, to start with you. Why is there a resistance of using...
No, we are slowly moving towards FOLFOXIRI. FOLFIRINOX in colorectal cancer. Wherever, like in rectal cancers, in adjuvant settings, suppose the CRM is threatened and it is not this, there is high chances still be positive. We are using FOLFIRINOX.
So that's a new adjuvant, like the PRODIGY.
Yeah. But in the metastatic setting, yeah, you are right. We have apprehensions. Probably we need to break this barrier. And as you rightly said, we have enough experience in using it in other things. I think it's just a mindset which we need to change.
So, Sen, would you change your answer from FOLFOX-BEV to FOLFOXIRI-BEV for this patient?
Yes, maybe. But if it is not, let's take the COVID era out. If COVID era is not there, definitely yes.
Okay. What about you, Bhavesh, sir?
No, I'm still stick to the doublet rather than triplet. Means doublet with BIVA and doublet with anti-EGFR or anti-HER2. Or again, as you rightly told, whether we does not know whether immuno and chemo combination will be much better or not. I will use a doublet with some combination of some, like if we discuss NGS, and if we found a really good target, then I will go for chemo plus targeted rather than triplet chemotherapy.
Dr. Vishwanath, can I have your opinion on this?
Yeah, I think even I would be tempted to give a triplet in this case.
Right. So, excellent. So, this was, I think so, in my opinion, the single most important abstract in this ASCO, as far as colorectal cancer goes, because the Pembro and Darutuxican, we don't have these resources in our country. But what this Dr. Krimalini and group did is they did an IPD meta-analysis of all the trials, all the patients who were on triplet versus doublet. And without any question of doubt, there was a significant improvement in overall survival, irrespective of sidedness, as you can see in this forest group, that whether it was a right side or a left side, whether it was BRAF or it was not BRAF, using triplet first line versus using a doublet and then sequencing them with another agent, you are always going to lose on overall survival as well as progression-free survival. So in my opinion, this is the most standout paper in this ASCO 2020. And this only increases our confidence. And we've been using triplet in all other cancers for our biliary tract, pancreatic. So we must move towards triplet in especially young patients who are able to tolerate it. And the same thing is with NCCN. So people tell me, what does NCCN say? So NCCN definitely has put a triplet option right there as category 2A in patients who are appropriate for intensive therapy. Now, mind you, this intensive therapy is not only to convert, because there is a feeling that only if you want to convert the patient, you use a triplet, but that's not the case. Mm-hmm. Even if you don't want to convert, just need a response, young fit patient, I think so triplet is the way to go. So Atul Sharma sir, what do you say? What is your experience of triplet in gallbladder? I always wanted to ask you, sir.
So gallbladder, probably we have written manuscript, probably maybe that couple of weeks it will be published somewhere. So it does give a lot of toxicity. About 30-40% patient will develop some kind of grade 3 or 4 toxicity, mainly being the diarrhea and vomiting. Neutropenia, thrombocytopenia is not that problem, because in the particular study which I did for the gallbladder cancer, we used the prophylactic UCSF. And so there may be some delays by about a couple of days. No toxic death, very well manageable toxicity profile. You just need a couple of days of the delay. Response rate in gallbladder cancer are in the tune of 45%. Another 25% patient, these are the, I'm talking about the partial response, objective responses. About 25-30% patient will have the disease stabilization. So it's in the tune of 70-75% partial response versus disease stabilization.
If I may ask, what is the
metastatic unresectable could undergo the resection also R0. So now we are thinking of the two projects. One, of course, first line comparing gemcitabine versus FOLFIRINOX. And also in the adjuvant setting, or at least for the borderline resectable patient.
And what is the dose of irinotecan can you use when we use triplet?
150.
150. Okay. 150.
So there was a very interesting Spanish paper which said if you reduce down to 135 per meter square, the toxicity of this diarrhea specifically, which is very nuisance, that reduces tremendously while keeping the efficacy nearly the same. But it is up to the debate. So in my practice, I reduced down to 135 to 140. Okay. So in this patient, I did, so let's say we did 4 months of FOLFOXIRI. Mind you, when we do a triplet, we don't go all the way to 12 cycles. We always stop at 4 cycles because of the risk of this. And then this patient was put on maintenance. And then, of course, this patient had new lung lesions. So, what about second-line therapy in this patient? So, if we have used triplet, what would be the second-line, Dr. Sumit Goyal?
See, we have the option of either using regorafenib, or we have the option of using either the immunotherapy, the checkpoint inhibitors, IO here, or,
yes.
Or the other 5-FU derivatives like the TAS-102 we can use. But... I'll probably go with IO drug here.
Okay, so we discussed that IO is out of this discussion because none of you said IO first line.
Okay, so IO is out. So if IO is out, maybe Regora?
So second line regorafenib?
No, not the second, but we have used triplet we have used, right?
But we stopped before progression. We stopped after 4 months.
Yeah, we can reintroduce and see.
Right, and would you continue any targeted therapy?
Yeah, Bev, I will continue.
What about ramucirumab or aflibercept?
See, switching between one VEGF to the other has not shown any benefit, as far as I remember and know. So, whether we switch to ramucirumab or continue with Bev should not make a difference. And other correct. VEGF inhibitors also, yeah.
Dr. Bhavesh, sir, what about you? What would you do?
Muted, I will unmute. In this particular case, because we had used initially triplet and it was a very good response, that's why might be we had used a maintenance, and that maintenance against capox with beva. So I still feel that so we can now use, because the progression and again the patient symptomatic, because now is the performance status is very important. And the other parameters like liver mass, the other liver function test and other things. But I will consider again, might be a single agent, capecitabine or single agent tega for UT, or even the use of practically FOLFOX again, that will be a much better option, depend on the patient performance status.
Would you continue targeted therapy after progression?
No, I will not use. I will not continue the targeted therapy.
Dr. Randeep Singh, sir, what about you?
Oh, I will, yes. So I will be using a FOLFOX series and ramucirumab, because in the ramucirumab trial, 15-20% of the patients had received BEV and still they had shown the response. I am also open to use FOLFOX series plus BEV because there is a data of BEV beyond progression also in colorectal. So both the options, but I would prefer a FOLFOX series plus a ramucirumab. And if there is some cost problems and other than BEV is cheaper because of the generic, I may go for FOLFOX series and BEV.
And Dr. Vishwanath, sir, what about you?
Yeah, if the patient continues to have a good performance status, I would re-challenge with FOLFOX series plus BEV. If not, I would probably go for FOLFOX plus bevacizumab or FOLFIRI plus bevacizumab.
Right. So the reason why I kept this slide is, if you can see the ramucirumab trial and aflibercept trial, they are what the word ramucirumab and aflibercept are actually the cancer. Because the BEV gives the same effect as they would give. And like you said, ramucirumab and aflibercept have a higher density. So that is why I put all the delta numbers in the bottom. So even NCCN suggests that if you want to use second line targeted therapy, bevacizumab is preferred over aflibercept and ramucirumab in the second line continuum of care. But yes, of course, one could use ramucirumab. Lily, people are pushing ramucirumab for rectal cancer. All right. So this patient had FOLFIRI BEV for 6 more months, did well, and then of course had progression. So last slide, I want to know what would be the third line, regorafenib versus something else, because this something else was also eye-catching to me in the current ASCO. So anybody would like to comment, Dr. Sumit? Mind you, this patient had a KRAS G12C mutation.
Yeah, the newer drug which has come into, which is there.
Code break 100. The code break.
Yeah, it's
100.
100.
The first drug that we have ever seen is that it targets KRAS, but only is this KRAS mutation, C variant. And to me, it's just a single agent and heavily pretreated, and you had a response rate of 20%. So this, I think, so will mark a new era for targeting patients into future. But so this was very exciting again to me in this current ASCO. But yes, and we have this regorafenib or TAS-102. Any quick comments, Dr. Vandit sir, or best supportive care?
So, no, if the patient is fit, he goes for regorafenib. I actually have no experience with TAS-102, so I shall admit that. And because I have no experience, my option will be regorafenib. And even in a PS2 patient also, we can start with a low dose of regorafenib. Generally, if the patient has to respond, they do respond rapidly. And you can start with a 40 mg and then 80 and then reach to the desired dose.
Yeah.
I think regorafenib is a better option.
With TAS-102, they can share actually. Viraj, you or Atul sir or anything, Sumit. It will be great if they can share it. Someone.
I have not used TAS-102.
We will have generic
one, but not TAS-102.
So if the performance status permits, of course, regorafenib remains a good choice.
So, Dr. Vishwanath, I would ask, if this patient was MSS, do you use Rego plus Nego? Any thoughts on that?
If it is MSS,
yes,
I wouldn't be using
it. I will use it. I have already counseled 2 patients about it.
Okay.
I think data is quite promising and we don't have anything to use, then I think this is the way forward we should try.
Okay.
Correct. So it's a very interesting phase 1 data, I'm sure.
If
you know, the 50 patients only.
Yeah,
we know response rate.
Yeah, response rates were very good, about 34%.
Yeah, so single agent Regora is 2% in colon, single agent Nevo in MSS is 0%, but if you combine them, it's 30-35%.
Yeah,
reduces the T index and allows the immunotherapy to flourish. And as far as already phase 3 already launched with Ego plus Rego in gastric as well as colon.
Yes, in colon cancer. Yeah.
So I think so. Once that comes, we would be using IO plus Rego rather than Rego alone. An end to today's discussion. Excellent discussion, all four of you. Thank you, Atul sir, and thank you, Purvis, again for giving me this chance. We can take questions, sir, if we have any.
Of course, we should take questions. Can I ask?
Sir, I have a question to our moderator and other panelists as well. Does anybody do a repeat biopsy at the time of progression to look for discordance? I know it is evolving, but is there any role for re-biopsy for looking for any discordance in the KRAS, NRAS, and BRAF?
So, does any of the panelists want to take?
At this point of time, we are not doing.
Okay.
So the data shows that in a metastatic setting, like in a first time or when it is a progression, there was not much discordant data about the extended RAS or BRAF type.
So, can I answer that, Purvis sir?
Please go ahead. Yeah, you are in charge.
So, yes, I am doing repeat biopsy in a particular subset. So, this is a subset who is all wild type to begin with, and you have treated them with anti-EGFR drugs. And when they have progressed, you have, of course, given them break from anti-EGFR drug and you put them to anti-VEGF drugs. But when is the time for the third line, when you have even exhausted that BEV, I do repeat biopsy. And I have four such cases, and I can share two cases where the RAS status. So in one case, when the EGFR was progressed, patient had a new RAS mutation. And the same patient, when I repeated after 8 months of bevacizumab, that patient did not have RAS mutation. Now, of course, this is one case, but if I have to quote you a literature, so there is a cricket trial, which is exactly what you are asking, proving this proof of concept that the RAS mutation, if it was wild type, it could evolve over with the therapy. It's a dynamic RAS. And if you give enough time, so there is something called as decay of RAS clones. So if you give them enough time, clones go over.
The clones will
recharge them in the IGFR. But I'm not sure there is any evidence which says if you are RAS mutant, you would lose RAS later on. It's the other way around. If you are wild type, you could develop mutation. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, thank you.
Viraj, please continue with the questions that are shown on the screen.
So, can you use Tegafur after progression on FOLFOX and CAPOX? In my practice, I do not use Tegafur.
Is Vivek Agarwal there?
Yeah, Dr. Vivek, he did a fantastic presentation. Can you comment?
Sir, I use Tegafur UFT in a subset of patients, but I don't use it after progression on 5-FU derivatives. Usually, I use it as maintenance in frail patients, which I think will require some form of therapy there, but not after progression on 5-FU.
So, I think the answer to this question is no.
Correct. Right. Similar question by Dr. Nilesh. In today's era, where would you put UFT? Because we were discussing all the hi-fi stuff, where would you put UFT in the current armamentarium? Bhavesh sir, can you answer that?
As Sumit also answered this question, that in a frail patient or in a maintenance, generally we are putting some type of patient on Tegafur.
Correct.
DPT deficiency, I will not use UFT.
So, I don't know answer to this one. Can anybody enlighten me? Can you actually use UFT in DPD?
I don't think so, because the other thing, the Tegafur Uracil, the Uracil is a DPD inhibitor. So, that will lead to potential toxicity. But I don't think we can use that there. So, that I think I will not use. Probably I'll need to check, but I will not use properly. It will cause DPD toxicity.
Anybody has any evidence to educate us or enlighten us? Because I'm not aware. of whether can we use UFT in DPD or not.
So my understanding was that we can use it in DPD deficient patients.
Okay. Okay. So this is a question from Dr. Girish. Can we use cetuximab once every 2 weeks instead of weekly? Certainly you can. Of course, you have to increase the dose. Dr. Bharat, sir, what's the role of increasing groups providing option of chemo administration at home? Fantastic question. So I have experience of my own. Can anybody... So I hope this is a secret session, right, Purvi sir?
Yes, it's we'll keep it confidential.
Okay. So anybody is doing chemo at home?
No. No.
So okay. There is a general consensus or resistance against chemo at home. And people are very skeptical about the services being provided. What is the quality? What is the quality assurance? And what will happen in case there is a mishap or an untoward accident? So yes, that is the general consensus.
Yes, agree, sir.
But I am also attended one webinar where in Delhi or some of the group is doing a very fantastic job with a very trained infrastructure or very trained nursing staff, and also with the all the kit also, emergency kit also. So they are doing a very good thing even in India, chemo at home. We have to need to train some of our own nursing staff and to educate the people as well as medical or paramedical staff.
So there are home healthcare companies that are able to set up a ICU at home also.
Yeah.
So with remote monitoring and equipment at home, where if a patient has no cost issues, then an entire ICU can be set up to give chemotherapy, including infusional 5-FU. But are we able to, you know, reassure ourselves in today's setting? I'm very skeptical.
Correct. This is a question from...
Raj, can I comment?
Yes.
Can I comment on this? Just a short one.
Yes, sir.
Purvish, sir, I agree there is a resistance. If my daycare staff is going and everything is covered and I know the moment reaction happens, my hospital sends the ambulance, patient comes to my daycare place, I am open. I mean, I know the competency of the staff. I know that the drug has been mixed in my daycare and then the person is carrying it, cold chain is maintained or the chain is maintained. Yes. And suppose there is a reaction to anything like a paclitaxel or maybe a gemcitabine, anything gemcitabine, and I know the staff can pick up fast with an ambulance support, I am then open to do it.
So you are absolutely right. I think we have to be in control.
I don't want to give it to third party. It's disastrous.
All right. So, Randeep, I totally agree with you. If you are in charge of the entire process, entire workflow, then it is reassuring and then it is possible to do that.
And sir, coming back to the previous question, as you said, you are right, sir. The partial DPD deficiency, UFT can be used.
Yes.
Okay, great. Now, this question from Dr. Dhanraj, any role of carcidox, deoxyfluoridine? I'm not aware.
So I think it was available for some time in the country, and probably if I am not wrong,
2005, 2006, 2008.
So this question from Dr. Bharat, yes, if there is MSI high, I would do immunotherapy and not chemo plus targeted therapy. Dr. Runu Sharma, what about repeating fulfoxyri? Yes.
Yeah, we repeated.
We could do it, but you would just add to neurotoxicity. So I would rather do fulfiri alone. Dr. Umang Mittal, if primary progression after Capox 3 cycles, but liver mets decrease, still unresectable, what to do? 74 years of age. Difficult question. So can we answer that?
Yeah, of course. Please go ahead.
So this patient has a differential response, if I understand. The primary is progressing and probably causing obstruction or anything, but the liver mets are responding. What would you do? But they're still unresectable. I think so we will change the chemotherapy. And if this is a left-sided disease, you might also need to divert this patient so that this patient does not end up in obstruction. Dr. Umang Mittal asks, legal status if patient dies at home chemotherapy. Purvis sir, what about this?
So the legal status is very clear. Whoever is in charge of administering the chemotherapy at home is responsible. But that doesn't mean that here there is negligence. That depends on the circumstances of the person. But the person who will have to answer is the one who was in charge of the chemotherapy administration, the doctor. So if I was the consultant at the hospital and I was talking to a RMO and RMO was administering at home, then RMO will have to answer what happened there. So earlier, you know, there was a unwritten rule that the captain of the ship is the doctor under whom the patient is admitted. Now there is, that is being blurred. And it is the person, especially after the telemedicine guidelines has come, if I'm on telemedicine consult and the doctor is at the next to the patient, it is the doctor next to the patient who is responsible.
And what if that doctor is an alternative medicine doctor?
That is a big problem. Because our allopathic telemedicine guidelines does not cover allopathic doctor. I mean, does not cover alternate medicine doctor.
Yeah. Excellent. We had a great questions.
Awesome. Virat, thank you so much. And sir, Randeep and Atul, please give the concluding remarks.
Okay, sir. Sir, can we allow there were two people who have raised hand or shall we close the session?
No, we allow. Please, sir. Of course. We are here to answer every question.
Dr. Venkat raised a hand. We can unmute Dr. Venkat and then Dr. Nagender. If both of anyone of them is there, Dr. Venkat followed by Dr. Nagender.
I'll unmute Dr. Nagender.
Yes, he had a comment he can make.
Sir, you'll have to unmute your mic, Dr. Sharma. Dr. Nagender Sharma, you'll have to unmute your mic.
I think he's not responding. Can we go to the next one?
Well, fine, sir. I think we have answered all the questions. And thank you, Purvish, sir. I would request, since Atul sir is there, that sir, can you just summarize the whole discussion in 5 minutes and then we close the session? I mean, just the final words, take home message, both from the trials presented by me, as well as a word about Tegafur-Uracil and the discussion in the COVID era. A very short, brief summary and take home for the audience. We have around 150, 170 audience were there. So we can, you can just summarize being expert in this field. It will be great, sir.
What I came to learn this evening is couple of things. Number one, so a lot of changes are occurring in the metastatic colorectal cancer. We need to understand and clearly understand that what are the molecular basis and what are all the tests which we need to do at the baseline. Whether it's all RAS, BRAF, HER2-new and this thing. But there was some discussing whether whether we do a single test like the NGS or we do a couple of tests. So probably difference of opinion. I personally don't do NGS at the first setting, though Vida did say that probably if given the chance, probably would like to go for that. That is definitely there. We have in for a subset of the patient who are expressing the MSI high status or now last yesterday or day before yesterday, if this is a high TMB itself, because we know sometimes there may be discordance between the two, then the immuno-oncology drugs become very, very important in eligible patient. Of course, there's the issue of the cost. And also the important thing about the probably the 3 versus 6 month debate has been kind of really what was the conclusion that the debate is settled, almost settled now. If you have a high risk patient, a 3 month of CAPOX may be in. But personally, I would like to say in case we are using FOLFOX, I personally still, though there was not significant difference, I personally still prefer to use if I have to use FOLFOX for this reason, either the infused some reason patient is not able to tolerate capecitabine, which happens sometime, or because of renal failure or renal status function being impaired, then probably would go for 6 months of the FOLFOX. Of course, now we data is emerging about the HER2-new targeted therapy for metastatic. Of course, we have the REGO and combination of the NEVO, which probably is going to be successful possibly in the near future available. And so that's it. Anything else probably? Somebody wants to add something?
Randeep.
A triplet. No, sir, no, nothing after
you. I would want you to endorse triplet today. So the three drug combination, particularly when you want to have a quicker response, that's where I put it at this thing. Having seen and used it in the gallbladder cancer, particularly the modified, which probably Veera said we need to still modify further, probably it is not a bad option, I would say that.
Thank you, Atul sir. It was actually, it was a very brief summary, and you have actually touched upon most of the discussion points. And with this, Purvish sir, you can just close the session, sir, please. Purvish sir? Sir, you have to unmute yourself.
Thanks, Shang. Yeah. Sure. So, Atul, Randeep, Vivek, Viraj, all the panelists, they've done a fantastic job. I think we have exceeded time by almost half an hour, and still almost 100 people are there. There were people joining from outside India as well. So, this has been an immensely successful webinar. And I must thank all the panelists as well as all the participants. You saw all the questions that were really interesting and practical. So I'm sure that we have made a meaningful difference to the outcome of patients by doing this interaction. So I thank all of you again once more, and we declare the meeting closed. Thank you very much.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.